Hi everyone, welcome to Behind the Code. In today's episode, we're going to be talking all about using the data layer. And actually today we're going to be talking a little bit more abstractly about the data layer. As most of you probably know it, the data layer is something you might use in conjunction with Google Tag Manager, for example. So you might have some analytics tags in Google Tag Manager, and then you push information into the data layer from your page, and that fires the tags. And that's kind of the common use case. But we're actually designing the data layer to be a messaging bus that any vendor, not just Google Tag Manager, but other vendors and services might be able to consume as well. So we're going to talk about what the data layer is and also how other services outside of Tag Manager can also consume the information in the data layer using a open source library that we recently published. So to help us do that, I've actually got Brian Kuhn, who's a tech lead on the Tag Manager project, and Lukas Bergstrom, who's our product manager as well. Brian, do you want to give just like a quick summary of what you do on the team? What's your role?
Yeah, sure. So I lead the engineering team in charge of Google Tag Manager. I was involved with Google Analytics for a long time, writing their tracking code, and that evolved into the product we built for Tag Manager.
Cool. And Lukas?
I'm the product manager for Google Tag Manager. And so originally, in ancient times, a software engineer, and then kind of lost the plot and ended up as a PM. Mm-hmm. But I work on, you know, collaborating with Brian on the product roadmap, being this kind of central point of integration for sales, marketing, support, engineering, to make sure that everybody is talking to each other and coordinated.
Cool. So it's safe to say that between the two of you, you guys are kind of steering Tag Manager.
Hopefully.
Right?
Yeah.
And the data layer.
We're trying.
Trying. Cool. Well, let's get into it. Just quick show the agenda, roughly, of what we're going to talk about. We'll kind of talk about an overview of the data layer and some of the design principles behind it. We'll talk about using the data layer to track state and events, show some example use cases for when a data layer might be particularly useful, and then we'll give you some resources at the end. So let's jump right into it. Maybe we'll start with the overview right at the beginning. And maybe, Lukas, I'll start with you.
Sure.
Basically, what problem is the data layer solving? What was wrong with the way people were tracking before?
So when you talk about tracking user behavior on the web, I think the first thing that people think about is kind of page view tracking, right? That at the base level, you started out by everyone put a Google Analytics tag on every page of their site, and then they could see which pages got the most traffic and where people were coming from. We're a long way from that now. Right, we now are in a world where people want to know, who interacted with this image carousel, who added something to their shopping cart more than $500 in value.
Right.
We want to know like really detailed stuff about what user behavior is, and all of that requires little bits of JavaScript, that ping servers with data. And so where we are today is we've got maybe the next slide would be good here.
Yeah,
we've got dozens of different services that we use for things like web analytics, conversion tracking, remarketing, and they all have their own implementations of this is how you send me data.
Right.
And we've got on the next slide a bunch of different stuff that we want to track, and what that leads to is kind of these we've got M events, N services we need to track them with.
Right.
So we got just this matrix of different ad hoc implementations that
a mess.
they get broken every time your site changes, and so the idea of the data layer is instead, on the next slide, let's just kind of abstract away that and just say like, all right, we're just gonna publish everything that happens on the page that we know we're interested in to just a common message bus, and then all these different services can subscribe to that. Right, so so that's kind of the idea. I think Brian can talk to what that gets you.
So as a developer, then your concern is less how do I interact with all these different tracking libraries that I might be working with on the same page, and moves more to how do I just make sure that I'm exposing what the interesting things that are happening on my page.
Right.
Exactly.
Right. Exactly.
Cool. Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah. Cool. So there's obviously like a bunch of benefits. We kind of talked about a few of them there. It sounds like it makes things a little bit less complicated.
Yeah.
But do you want to cover some of these other ones as well? Because these are actually pretty interesting.
Yeah, I can probably talk some about this. So when we were designing the data layer, there were a couple of constraints that we wanted to deal with. We didn't want to slow down the page.
Yeah.
We didn't want to introduce any additional global variables other than just the single data layer. Because in the mess that he's talking about before, you end up with global variables for just about every single vendor that you're talking about, and sometimes multiple pieces of code in that global namespace. So the data layer really is confined to that single variable, that single message bus. The other thing that is interesting about the mess is that every vendor has their own different way of capturing this data. Mm-hmm. Some of them have synchronous APIs. Some of them have bootloaders that have to come in and pieces of JavaScript that have to load before mm-hmm. any of this happens. We wanted to avoid all that. So if you go to the next slide, I can show you.
Yeah.
The data layer really is a basic JavaScript array. I mean, it starts as a piece of code that you can put directly in the page. There's no bootloader. There's no piece of JavaScript that has to load and provide APIs. No complicated things for the page author to actually put into the page. Mm-hmm. Really, we wanted to keep this as simple as possible for the page author. So they really just have to define this one array and then basically append messages onto it.
Yeah, so it's basically, it's an array with some conventions around how you use it.
Right, right.
Exactly. Right.
Now, if you were using it with Google Tag Manager, for example, there is some code for Tag Manager that you would also need to include in addition to the...
Right, so that's another a goal of this is really so that you're instrumenting your site once,
right.
And any vendors that are on the page, like Google Tag Manager or Google Analytics or other vendors out there, mm-hmm. They can consume that data. So this puts a little bit more work on the vendor side, but it keeps the page author's job very, very simple. They basically just create this array, push some messages onto it, and then any vendors that happen to be installed on the page can just consume that data as it comes in.
Right, right. Yep.
The other nice thing about this approach is that it allows these vendors to be loaded asynchronously. So again, they don't slow down the page either.
Mm-hmm.
So if they come along, they're not going to actually lose any of the data that you're appending onto the queue. So
right.
you append message, and then they come along somewhere along the line, and then they can actually see the entire history of what's been pushed,
mm-hmm.
and they can consume it piece by piece.
I see. That's cool.
Yep.
So you can see in this next slide, this is an example of an initial message on the data layer.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't actually, if your needs are simple and you really just have a static set of key value pairs,
right.
you can actually just do this.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you just basically have an array with a single message of it inside of it and then the key value pairs that you want to use. And then in the next slide, we can show you how later on, like let's say you've got that static set of key value pairs in the page.
Mm-hmm.
And let's say some event happens. You view a part of this. You view a part of the page, or you click on a link, or you view a carousel, like you said. You can instrument those actions in your page to push additional messages onto the queue, and they'll get processed in order by the various vendors that want to read those messages. And some vendors will ignore messages and not care about certain messages, but other vendors will. We'll care about your carousel link clicks.
Yeah. So basically, we're using the data layer for two different types of things, and one is sort of like, you know, this variable has this value. You know, it's maybe just like a static page level thing that you know when the page loads. But we're also using it for things are happening in time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this event just happened. Here are some associated values.
Right. Right.
Yeah.
And when you say vendor. Just so everybody's clear, would you consider Tag Manager itself one of those vendors?
Absolutely, yeah, absolutely.
So Tag Manager is one vendor, but there could be some other solution that also wants to use the data layer, which is
right.
fine.
Right, right.
Yep.
Right. We look at basically two actors here, the page author and vendors. So we want to keep it as simple as possible for those page authors.
Cool, yep.
So this gets actually into how vendors actually consume the messages that are being pushed onto the data layer.
Mm-hmm.
And now is probably a good time to talk about something Lukas was mentioning, which is the abstract data model underneath.
Yeah.
So for each message, you're going to pass in some key value pairs. So over time, we keep an internal memory of that, or a data, a storage location for all of those key value pairs, mm-hmm. basically keeping the most recent value for any given key. Mm-hmm. This kind of acts like a database for all of those key value pairs so that you can come along and it acts as a page view level storage, right. basically. So if you're using a tool like GTM or some other vendor, you can use like a macro to read those values at any given time. You don't have to be there at the time of the message.
Right.
Because this is kind of baked into GTM at the moment, we really wanted to make the point that these vendors out there other than GTM can also consume the data layer. Mm-hmm. So we actually put out a data layer helper library, which is basically the piece of GTM that consumes this piece of or consumes the messages and keeps track of the abstract data model.
Cool.
So this is actually out on GitHub right now. Mm-hmm. So vendors can actually go and play with it, incorporate it into their own products if they like, and we can start collaborating on kind of an industry standard.
Yep.
That's awesome.
Yep.
Awesome. And I think you mentioned industry standard. Was there some work you guys were doing around a W3C?
Yeah, so we're working with the W3C community group to develop, some kind of common approach to this. This is kind of the architecture side, like what's the, how do you actually encode, do this stuff? Another part of the W3C effort is what's the vocabulary you use? Mm-hmm. What are the key value pairs that describe e-commerce
right.
events?
Right.
We're working with this and proposing this as kind of the standard approach to, how you represent the data on page, So a common message bus that the other participants in W3C group are mostly other tag management systems.
Mm-hmm.
So this would be hopefully a common message bus that regardless of the tag management solution you're using,
right.
you can just push data to that and know that they'll be able to consume it successfully.
Right. So as the page author, you don't have to worry about dealing with different APIs for different.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. So you can use multiple vendors. You can switch vendors seamlessly. It's mm-hmm. it's very easy for you.
Yep.
Cool. That's awesome. Cool. And then I think, Lukas, you had some sort of examples of like real world use cases where a data layer would really be helpful.
Yeah. So kind of like, if you're who are examples of developers that would gain value from working with this, right? One example is e-commerce platform vendors. If you want your users to be able to track, visitor behavior, right? If you're a site like Yahoo Stores or Shopify, then you can either do dozens of ad hoc integrations, mm-hmm. right? Or you can basically push data and events onto the data layer, right, for vendors to consume,
right?
And in the near term, when there are vendors that still kind of haven't built in support for this, you may have a translation layer that listens for the stuff on the data layer. And then pushes it to the vendor in the format that they expect.
Mm-hmm.
But at least there you've you've abstracted away kind of like you don't have a direct coupling between this vendor and this button click
right.
on a button with this ID and class, right? All you need to know is what's the interesting stuff I want to track, and then map all those vendors onto the data layer format.
Yeah. Yeah.
So for e-commerce platform vendors, they just they get to basically just instrument the site once, and then their users can plug in whatever
right.
Performance tracking vendors they want.
On the other hand, would it make sense? So if you were pushing things to the data layer, and you're also using Google Tag Manager, mm-hmm. one such vendor,
yeah. mm-hmm.
and you can implement other vendors via tags in Google Tag Manager,
yeah.
then that would give you a complete solution
right,
without having to do the mapping.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
Yeah.
But otherwise, if you couldn't do that through GTM for whatever reason, you're talking about kind of having a second layer translation
right.
thing to look at the data layer and then make it into the format that the vendor needs.
Right? Yeah. So in the near term, as we're kind of building industry support,
mm-hmm.
You might need to build in kind of just little translation shims,
yeah.
but it's still like a net win because they're abstracted away from the particular like structure of like the website.
Yep. And then I think there was a
we've
talked about
yeah,
this.
We've been talking about this. So if you're a page author, you just need to think about the interesting events and data once, and then plug in vendors. So
cool. So I guess where do you guys? Looking, 2 or 3 years out? Like, how do you see, it sounds like you're seeing the data layer as kind of like a new standard way for page authors to be pushing this information. And hopefully we're gonna see other vendors, not just Google Tag Manager, but a lot of other solutions be able to read from that as well.
Yeah, we'd like to see this become the mechanism in which, you know, data is instrumented on the page. Mm-hmm. And it really is, you know, like I said, an event-driven model. So we're really trying to be capture all those data, all those pieces of data, not just like constants in the page, but all the data based on events happening throughout the page, you know, Ajax apps, things like that.
As sites get more and more dynamic, right, this is like the perfect architecture to support that.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And I think where we'd like to see this go, like one example of a change is, you know, have more and more content management systems self-instrument, right? Just have them by default be just pushing interesting stuff onto the data layer.
Yeah.
Because right now we live in a world where kind of you've got content management systems here, tag management systems here, and the CMS doesn't know anything about the TMS, these two parallel systems. So when the CMS changes, right, someone changes the structure of the site, your tag management setup might break.
Right.
Right. But if the CMS is self-instrumenting, you don't have that problem.
Right. Solved. Yeah. That's cool. And is this also apply? You guys work mainly with web apps, but does this also apply to the world of native apps? Because we do have a native app.
Yeah, we
SDK.
Use the same concept on the native apps, the mobile SDK as well.
So it's the same thing. It's not a dictionary on iOS. Mm-hmm.
Because there's no bootloading issues there, or having to load scripts and slow down the page, they can actually have a kind of a more rich API.
Mm-hmm.
But it's virtually the same.
Cool.
Same concepts.
Awesome. So we'll just get to some resources. Make sure you guys have links to some of the stuff that we talked about. We showed you the link earlier, but if you want to check out the Data Layer Helper Library, the open source library that's on GitHub, we have a link for you there. And this would really be for other vendors out there who might want to also consume data from the data layer.
Right, and this is open source. We expect this to be collaborative. Mm-hmm. If anybody wants to contribute, please let us know.
Yep.
Cool. And we did talk about a little bit about Tag Manager. Tag Manager obviously works very well with the data layer, and you can implement a lot of other vendors' tags through GTM. So if you haven't checked it out yet, you can see Tag Manager at google.com/tagmanager. Cool. And I think that's it for today. If you have any questions, as always, feel free to reach out to us on G+, or reach out to me on G+ as well. Brian and Lukas, thank you guys so much for joining us.
Thanks, Andrew.
Thanks. Cool.
And thank you guys, and we'll see you next time.